Laudato Jesus Christus, praised be Jesus Christ. A very warm welcome to you on behalf of Vatican Radio, Vatican Media, and all my colleagues here at the Vatican Dicastery for Communication. I'm Sean Patrick Lovett. It's my privilege to provide the commentary for this live broadcast of Pope Francis' visit to the town of Greccio. Greccio is in Rieti. It's about a 20-minute helicopter flight from Rome, which is exactly what the Holy Father has just undertaken. He arrived here literally a few minutes ago from the Vatican, stepped off the helicopter, met with a group of sick and disabled people, and has now been driven by car to the area in the town where he will be presenting his new apostolic letter. It's an apostolic letter called Admirabile Signum, and we'll be hearing more about that during the course of this broadcast. On whatever platform, device, or medium you may be following this event, please know we're delighted you could join us. We welcome especially our friends of Catholic TV, Salt and Light TV, Shalom World TV, EWTN TV, and of course, all of you who are listening on local radio stations around the world. This broadcast is available live to you right now on our Vatican Media audio app and Vatican News portal. You can access that at vaticannews.va. That's Vatican News with two N's. Again, we are broadcasting to you live from the town of Greccio. Greccio is a small hill town, and the reason the Holy Father is here is because we're 3 weeks away from Christmas. And this is the place where Saint Francis of Assisi, in the year 1223, set up the first Christmas crib. His first biographer, Tommaso da Celano, gives us a detailed account of that Christmas Eve here in Greccio. St. Francis was visiting the town on his way back from Rome in 1223, where he had gone to have his rule approved by the Pope. He had also visited the Holy Land sometime before that, and stopping here at this small town, he was reminded, he said, of the landscape of Palestine, the hills and trees and vegetation and stone houses, and he was inspired to set up the first Christmas crib here using a tableau vivant, using the local townspeople and using a live ox and donkey. Pope Francis is visiting this site, and he will be presenting here his latest apostolic letter. This is not Pope Francis' first visit to Greccio. He came to the sanctuary. The sanctuary is run by the Franciscan friars. He made a private visit to the sanctuary of Greccio on January 4th, 2016. And he came to pray before the medieval fresco that commemorates the first representation of the Nativity. If you're seeing images right now, if you are following this broadcast, and then you will see that the person beside him is the Bishop of Rieti. His name is Domenico Pompili, and the Pope is being accompanied also by the guardian of the Franciscan sanctuary here at Greccio. He's Franciscan Father Francesco Rossi. Pope Francis is greeting members of that community right now, and then we will move on to what is essentially a liturgy of the word. We will be hearing reflections by some Franciscans who've been selected to read us excerpts from the life of Saint Francis of Assisi by Tommaso da Celano. Tommaso da Celano was born around 1185. He died at the age of 75 years of age in 1260. He was an Italian Franciscan friar. He actually wrote three biographies about Saint Francis of Assisi, and he is credited as being the saint's first and most authoritative biographer. Again, if you have the opportunity to see the images, you're getting a privileged insight into the sanctuary of Greccio, the Franciscan sanctuary. This is the site, this is the place where Francis set up that Christmas, that first Christmas crib, and this is the medieval, this ancient medieval fresco that depicts this an event that saw the participation of all the townspeople at the time. Francis called his friars to help him organize this, and they organized a torchlight procession through the town with everyone bringing whatever they could and reenacting that scene of Christ's nativity, and a scene that involved everyone, not just the shepherds, the poor people, the simple townsfolk, but all the different artisans and young and old who lived in the town at the time. In fact, when Pope Francis visited here in 2016, he met a group of young people. They were here to participate in a diocesan meeting dedicated to his encyclical letter, Laudato Si. And although the Pope didn't give any official discourse on that occasion, he did talk to the young people and invited them to follow the star, to be like the Magi, to have the humility to discover Jesus in the humble and the poor, those who are discarded from society. In the visitor's register, in the guest book that's kept just a few feet away here in the sanctuary, Pope Francis wrote his gratitude to our Lord for the grace of this place, asking him to bless the church, the friars, and the faithful, and again asking that the Lord help us all to discover the star and to look for the child. And in a sense, that's one of the subtexts of his coming here this afternoon. As we move towards Christmas, it's so easy to be caught up in the consumerism and the frenzy of buying and selling that accompanies this festivity. And so almost before that happens, on the 1st of December, Pope Francis draws our attention back to the true significance of this festivity, this celebration, this reenactment of the birth of Jesus, God who comes down to earth and makes himself one of us. Pope Benedict XVI made several references to Greccio. He spoke about it during his Christmas Eve Mass on December 24th, 2011, and he literally recalled that moment in 1223 when St. Francis celebrated Christmas in Greccio, and he said it made visible a new dimension of the mystery of Christmas, calling it the Feast of Feasts. Saint Francis, said Pope Benedict, discovered a whole new depth to the humanity of Jesus. Pope Benedict in that homily said that Christmas has become a feast of shopping. And so again, we pray to the Lord to help us to see through the glittering facade of this time and to search for the child behind this facade, the child who waits for us in the stable at Bethlehem. Pope St. John Paul II made a pastoral visit to Rieti in Greccio. That was way back in January of 1983. And he too spoke about the special mystique of this place, calling Greccio almost a second Bethlehem, he said. Greccio addresses the person of today, surrounded by a disturbing void of values. This is Pope John Paul II. And takes us back to the message of peace and salvation that we find expressed in the incarnate Word, in the divine child, who still reaches out and wants to convert the hearts of every generation, who continues to invite all of us to experience his love. Pope Francis, still in prayer before the medieval image fresco that reproduces that moment in 1223 here in the in the grotto, in this tiny space, almost recalling that tiny space, that grotto in Bethlehem, where Jesus was born. Accompanied by Archbishop Rino Fisichella, who's responsible for new evangelization, and the Bishop of Rieti, Domenico Pompili. He will now go out into the square where the entire population of Greccio and Rieti is waiting to welcome him. You see him stopping just for a few moments again before the Franciscan community. The Franciscans are the guardians of this sanctuary. I always like to stress that the very first people the Pope spent time with here as he stepped off the helicopter was with a group of sick and disabled people. And if you didn't have a chance to see that, then that was very moving. It always is, because he takes his time, he touches, he embraces, he engages with the disabled and the sick. And not just with them, but with their caregivers, with the parents and spouses, those who take care of them.
Non si tratta di fare proselitismo, di convincere lo spirito.
He's telling the friars that evangelization is not about proselytizing. It's the Holy Spirit. You saw him pointing upwards. It's the Spirit that convinces people. And we convince them through our testimony, through our witness. Book of Genesis says the Pope reminds us that we are made of earth. We come from the earth. So we communicate the love of Jesus, poverty, humility. Miracles we'll leave to God, he says. The friars thank him for his visit. May the Lord bless your every step, says the woman religious. We pray for you, the friars say. We always pray for you. And they recite an Our Father together.
Venga il tuo regno, sia fatta la tua volontà, come in cielo e così in terra. Dacci oggi il nostro pane quotidiano, e rimetti a noi i nostri debiti, come noi li rimettiamo ai nostri debitori. E non ci indurre in tentazione, ma liberaci dal male.
The Holy Father gives the community his blessing. And he says, if you have a minute or two, remember to pray for me. And he asks them about the bishop, he asks, is the bishop behaving himself? Do you think I can go outside with him? He asks the friars. Very informal exchange, but the Holy Father is asking the young friar, he says, the young friar said that he'd visited Jerusalem and that he had visited the tomb in Jerusalem, Christ's tomb, and the Pope asks him, do you believe in the resurrection? Everybody, of course, wants to get a word in. And as usual, Pope Francis doesn't seem to be in any hurry whatsoever. It's the bishop who is trying to hurry things along, quite rightly so, because he knows that there are people outside, there's a program to follow, and I'm sure he doesn't want the Holy Father to get too tired either. So, just time for the group photograph. And the Pope says, it's okay, you can put your hand on my shoulder, it's fine. You can imagine how precious this photo will be. Very, very intimate, very relaxed encounter here between Pope Francis and the Franciscan community of Greccio, because that's where we are, that's where we're broadcasting to you from, the town of Greccio, near Rieti, to the north of Rome. Pope Francis is enjoying himself, as you can gather. He likes informal meetings. I'm sure you know that very well. He's not a man for formal gatherings. He enjoys the human contact. They want more pictures, more hands on the shoulder, more group photographs, and he doesn't pull back. He says, fine, go ahead. But I think that's it. I think if the bishop has anything to say about this, that's enough of that, and he wants the Pope to come out to begin the liturgy of the word. Signing autographs, taking pictures. If you've just joined us, remember you're attuned to Vatican Radio, Vatican Media, broadcasting to you live from the town of Greccio, the town where in the year 1223, Saint Francis of Assisi celebrated Christmas with an ox, a donkey, and a manger full of hay in order to make visible the mystery of Christmas. Here's the Pope. You can see the hillsides round about, and you can imagine why St. Francis of Assisi was inspired by this area and why this particular area reminded him of the Holy Land of Palestine, from which he had just returned on pilgrimage. The Pope is greeting young people and families, some of them dressed in local costume. The Bishop, Domenico Pompili, was telling the Pope a moment ago that the main mass on Christmas Day is at Christmas Eve is at 11 p.m. and that people dress up and reenact the Christmas nativity scene very much in the way that St. Francis of Assisi intended it to be reenacted, with the participation of all the town's people as a living tableau. Greccio is a medieval hill town. It's almost like a miniature version of Assisi, if you're more familiar with that. You see these honed rock and stone walls overlooking the valley and the countryside and the mountains. It's a beautiful place to relax and to reflect. And it's no surprise that St. Francis of Assisi was struck by this area way back in 1223. I don't think that the central part of the town has changed much, probably, since then. So in order to visit the grotto where that original, that very, very first nativity scene was set up, you actually have to go downstairs. And again, if you're watching, you saw it, you go downstairs beneath the church, which is set up in the main town square. Pope Francis in his element as he greets the children of the town. And the song they're singing this is obviously a song that they've been taught by their school teachers. We give the Pope the hand of Lady Poverty. I think someone just told him that his name is Francesco also, Francis. Let's go, let's go. Andiamo, 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 let's go. We ask for the hand of Lady Poverty. The Pope stands there patiently listening to this song. The children have probably been practicing for days at school, and he's going to hear it through until the end. Great excitement now, as you can see the Pope's assistant is handing out these little pouches with rosaries blessed by the Holy Father. I heard a squeaky voice say, "Can I have one too, please?" I'm sure he'll get one too. These lovely little rosaries, beautiful keepsakes. I know people who have rosaries like this that go way back, five or six popes, and are kept as family heirlooms, as very precious reminders of their meeting with a pope. He asks what it is. Little parchment. And the Pope stops to read it all, and he... it looks like it could be a poem or something, but the Pope seems very grateful for it. What you're seeing now did not happen back in 2016, so you can really consider this the Pope's first official visit to the town of Greccio. When he came here on January 4th, 2016, he came privately because he wanted to pray in front of the fresco you saw earlier. So this is really his first official visit to the town, and he's making the most of it by spending time with the townspeople. As usual, a lot of people want to give him something. It's either in the form of a small gift or a note. Sometimes it's a prayer request. Sometimes it's just to tell him that they love him and pray for him. And the children are still singing, as you can hear in the background. Way back in 1983, Pope St. John Paul II made a a whole day pastoral visit to the town of Greccio. He gave several discourses, one to the church community, one to the civil community of the diocese, and spoke at length about the symbolism of this town, reminding people that Greccio was the source of inspiration to St. Francis of Assisi to recreate in great simplicity, in what he called tender and human simplicity, the moment of Christ's birth. Francis has entered the little church at last, and you hear the choir singing the Italian version of Silent Night. Tiny stone church,
in nome del Padre, del Figlio, dello Spirito Santo.
And the liturgy has begun.
Pace sia con voi.
Peace be with you.
Fratelli e sorelle, 8 secoli fa San Francesco, imitando gli eventi accaduti nella grotta di Betlemme, ha preparato con
Eight centuries ago, St. Francis, imitating the events that took place in the grotto in Bethlehem, prepared the first living crib together with his followers. This beautiful tradition quickly spread among the faithful, becoming an icon of the infinite mercy of God who gives his only Son. The crib is reproduced every year, recalling the first coming of the Lord into the world, being born on the margins of society, in a manger, among animals and simple people. Let us gather ourselves in prayer for a moment as we listen to the Word of God and reflect on the mystery of Christmas. Let us pray.
Concedi a noi che sulla terra contempliamo la venuta del tuo Figlio di partecipare alla sua gloria nel cielo.
O God, you who every year allow us to live in the joy of Christmas time, allow us who on earth contemplate the coming of your Son to participate in his glory in heaven.
Ascoltate le parole dal Vangelo secondo Luca.
And a reading now from the Gospel according to St. Luke. It's Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 14. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be enrolled. This was the first enrollment when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to be enrolled, each in his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the city of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be enrolled with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child.
Mentre si trovavano in quel luogo, si compirono per lei i giorni del parto.
And while they were there, the time came for her to be delivered, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
Alcuni pastori che pernottando all'aperto vegliavano.
And in that region there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night.
Un angelo del Signore si presentò a loro e la gloria del Signore.
And an angel of the Lord appeared to them.
Essi furono
and the glory of the Lord shone around them.
Ma l'angelo disse
loro. And they were filled with fear.
Non temete.
And the angel said to them, be not afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of a great joy, which will come to all the people. For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger.
Una moltitudine
and suddenly
dell'esercito celeste,
there was with the angel a multitude
Dio,
of the heavenly host,
diceva,
praising God and saying,
Dio nel più alto dei cieli,
glory to God in the highest,
terra,
and on earth peace among
ama.
Those with whom he is pleased. We're going to listen now to an extract from the biography of St. Francis of Assisi, written by Tommaso da Celano. This is what it says. Francis meditated the words of the Lord continuously and never lost sight of his works. But above all, the humility of the Incarnation and the love expressed through the Passion made such a strong impression on his memory that it was hard for him to think about anything else. In this sense, it's worthy to recall that to celebrate with devotion that which the saint created 3 years before his glorious death in Greccio on the day of the Lord's birth. The saint stood in ecstasy before the crib, his spirit stirred with inexpressible joy. Then a priest solemnly celebrated the Eucharist over the crib, himself experiencing a consolation he'd never felt before. Francis put on the diaconal liturgical vestments, because he was a deacon, and proclaimed the Holy Gospel in a loud voice, that strong and sweet voice, so clear and resonant, filled everyone with heavenly desires. Then he spoke to the people, and with the sweetest of words, recalled the newborn poor king and the small town of Bethlehem. One of those present, a virtuous man, had a wonderful vision. He appeared to see the Christ child lying lifeless in the manger, and Francis going up to him and arousing him from that deep sleep. The prodigious vision did not contradict reality, because thanks to the saint, the child Jesus came alive in the hearts of many of those who had forgotten him, and the memory of him remained fixed in their minds. At the conclusion of that solemn vigil, everyone returned home, filled with unspeakable joy.
Quanti pensieri si affollano nella mente in questo luogo santo. E tuttavia davanti.
How many thoughts crowd the mind in this holy place? And yet before the rocks of these mountains that were so dear to St. Francis, what we are called to do, first of all, is to rediscover simplicity.
E per la prima volta San Francesco realizzò proprio in questo piccolo spazio.
The crib, which St. Francis created for the first time in this small space, in imitation of the tiny cave of Bethlehem, speaks for itself. There's no need for many words here. Because the scene before our eyes expresses the wisdom we need in order to grasp what is essential.
Per la nostra vita, così spesso frenetica, trovare momenti di silenzio.
Before the crib, we discover how important it is in our often hectic lives to find moments of silence and prayer. Silence to contemplate the beauty of the face of the child Jesus, the Son of God, born in the poverty of a stable. Prayer to express our amazed thank you at this immense gift of love we have been given. In this simple and enchanting image of the crib, which popular piety has embraced and passed on from generation to generation, the great mystery of our faith is made manifest. God loves us to the point of sharing our humanity and our lives. He never leaves us alone. He accompanies us with his hidden but not invisible presence. In every situation, in both joy and pain, he is Emmanuel, God with us. Like the shepherds of Bethlehem, let us accept the invitation to go to the cave, to see and recognize the sign that God has given us. Then our hearts will be full of joy, and we will be able to take that joy to wherever there is sadness. They will be full of hope to be shared with those who have lost it. Let us identify with Mary, who placed her son in the manger because there was no room in a house. With her and Saint Joseph, her husband, let us look to the Christ child. May his smile that lightens up the night dispel indifference and open hearts to the joy of those who feel loved by our Heavenly Father. Pope Francis' reflections here in Greccio. He's come here to sign his latest apostolic letter, a gesture that he performed earlier in the grotto that marks the place where St. Francis of Assisi created the first Christmas crib in 1223. We're in the tiny church just above that grotto. And Pope Francis is presiding over a brief liturgy of the word. We heard the
Il Santo Padre reading consegnerà ora la sua lettera from St. Luke.
We heard
signum,
an extract from
nella grotta del
Tommaso da Celano.
Data
and the host tells us that at this moment the Holy Father will deliver his apostolic letter, Admirabile Signum. Yeah, you see him doing so, symbolically handing over the letter that he signed a few moments ago in the grotto. The letter is handed over to various groups, to young people, and of course the symbolism is quite clear. You hand over the letter in order that they now spread the news, divulge and communicate the contents of that letter. It's a beautiful letter, and as soon as you can, I encourage you to read it. It's quite inspirational, especially at this time of year as we move closer towards Christmas. Do remember that everything you're hearing and seeing will be available in a few moments on our website, vaticannews.va. You'll be able to read extracts from the letter. You'll be able to watch these images again and share this broadcast that you're participating in right now. It'll be available also on our social media platforms. Those wearing the sashes, the so-called tricolor, the red, white, and green, the colors of the Italian flag, are evidently members of the city council. And so amongst the symbolism of those to whom the document is consigned, we have not just the new generations, the young people — there were some very young people, some children there as well — but to those in authority, those the decision makers of society, they too need to be aware of the contents of this apostolic letter. The title you heard is Admirabile Signum, and the name in Latin — papal letters are officially always published in Latin — the Latin refers to the words enchanting image, and that's the way the Pope's letter begins. And of course, the enchanting image he refers to is the Christmas creche, the Christmas crib, the nativity scene, the presepe, they call it in Italian. There'll be a beautiful moment in a few days' time when the Pope inaugurates the Christmas nativity scene in St. Peter's Square. It's always a monumental sculpture. People come from all over to admire it. And the Christmas tree, the Vatican Christmas tree, will be erected also in St. Peter's Square. And then there's a lovely moment in a few weeks when the children of Rome bring what are known as the bambinelli, the baby Jesus, the little statues, little images of the baby Jesus that will be placed in their Christmas cribs, their nativity scenes at home. It's during an Angelus on a Sunday at midday, and the children of Rome arrive in the square and hold up these images for the Pope's blessing as they prepare their own Christmas nativity scenes.
Il mirabile segno del presepe, così caro al popolo cristiano, suscita sempre stupore.
Two readers will be reading the contents of the message to us, and with your permission I will do the same. So here it is. Pope Francis' Apostolic Letter, Admirabile Signum, on the meaning and importance of the nativity scene. The enchanting image of the Christmas creche, so dear to the Christian people, never ceases to arouse amazement and wonder. The depiction of Jesus' birth is itself a simple and joyful proclamation of the mystery of the incarnation of the Son of God. The nativity scene is like a living gospel rising up from the pages of sacred scripture. As we contemplate the Christmas story, we're invited to set out on a spiritual journey, drawn by the humility of the God who became man, in order to encounter every man and woman. We come to realize that so great is his love for us that he became one of us, so that we in turn might become one with him. With this letter, I wish to encourage the beautiful family tradition of preparing the nativity scene in the days before Christmas, but also the custom of setting it up in the workplace, in schools, hospitals, prisons and town squares. Great imagination and creativity is always shown in employing the most diverse materials to create small masterpieces of beauty. As children, we learn from our parents and grandparents to carry on this joyful tradition, which encapsulates a wealth of popular piety. It's my hope that this custom will never be lost, and that wherever it's fallen into disuse, it can be rediscovered and revived. The origin of the Christmas creche is found above all in certain details of Jesus' birth in Bethlehem, as related in the Gospels. The evangelist Luke says simply that Mary gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. Because Jesus was laid in a manger, the nativity scene is known in Italian as a presepe, from the Latin meaning presepium, meaning manger. Coming into this world, the Son of God was laid in the place where animals feed. Hay became the first bed of the one who would reveal himself as the bread come down from heaven. St. Augustine, with the other church fathers, was impressed by this symbolism. Laid in a manger, he became our food. Indeed, the nativity scene evokes a number of the mysteries of Jesus' life and brings them close to our own daily lives. But let's go back to the origins of the Christmas creche so familiar to us. We need to imagine ourselves in the little Italian town of Greccio, near Rieti. St. Francis stopped there, most likely on his way back from Rome, where on the 29th of November 1223 he had received the confirmation of his rule from Pope Honorius III. Francis had earlier visited the Holy Land, and the caves in Greccio reminded him of the countryside of Bethlehem. It may also be that the poor man of Assisi had been struck by the mosaics in the Roman Basilica of St. Mary Major, depicting the birth of Jesus, close to the place where, according to an ancient tradition, the wooden panels of the manger are preserved. The Franciscan sources describe in detail what then took place in Greccio. 15 days before Christmas, Francis asked a local man named John to help him realize his desire to bring to life the memory of that babe born in Bethlehem, to see as much as possible with my own bodily eyes the discomfort of his infant needs, how he lay in a manger, and how with an ox and an ass standing by he was laid upon a bed of hay. At this, his faithful friend went immediately to prepare that which the saint had asked. On December the 25th, many friars came to Greccio from various parts, together with people from the farmsteads in the area, who brought flowers and torches to light up that holy night. When Francis arrived, he found a manger full of hay, an ox, and a donkey. All those present experienced a new and indescribable joy in the presence of the Christmas scene. The priest then solemnly celebrated the Eucharist over the manger, showing the bond between the incarnation of the Son of God and the Eucharist. At Greccio, there were no statues. The nativity scene was enacted and experienced by all who were present. This is how our tradition began, with everyone gathered in joy around the cave, with no distance between the original event and those sharing in its mystery. Thomas of Celano, the first biographer of St. Francis, notes that this simple and moving scene was accompanied by the gift of a marvelous vision. One of those present saw the baby Jesus himself lying in the manger. From the nativity scene of that Christmas in 1223, everyone went home with joy.
San Francesco, con la semplicità di quel segno, realizzò una grande opera di.
With the simplicity of that sign, St. Francis carried out a great work of evangelization. His teaching touched the hearts of Christians and continues today to offer a simple yet authentic means of portraying the beauty of our faith. Indeed, the place where this first nativity scene was enacted expresses and evokes these sentiments. Greccio has become a refuge for the soul, a mountain fastness wrapped in silence. Why does the Christmas creche arouse such wonder and move us so deeply? First, because it shows God's tender love. The Creator of the universe lowered himself to take up our littleness. The gift of life in all its mystery becomes all the more wondrous as we realize that the Son of Mary is the source and sustenance of all life. In Jesus, the Father has given us a brother who comes to seek us out whenever we are confused or lost, a loyal friend ever at our side. He gave us his Son who forgives us and frees us from our sins. Setting up the Christmas creche in our homes helps us to relive the history of what took place in Bethlehem. Naturally, the Gospel remains our source for understanding and reflecting on that event. At the same time, its portrayal in the creche helps us to imagine the scene. It touches our hearts and makes us enter into salvation history as contemporaries of an event that is living and real in a broad gamut of historical and cultural contexts. In a particular way, from the time of its Franciscan origins, the nativity scene has invited us to feel and touch the poverty that God's Son took upon himself in the Incarnation. implicitly, it summons us to follow him along the path of humility, poverty, and self-denial that leads from the manger of Bethlehem to the cross.
Mi piace ora passare in rassegna I vari segni del presepe
per continue the reading of Pope Francis' apostolic letter, in which he writes, I would like now to reflect on the various elements of the Nativity scene in order to appreciate their deeper meaning. First, there's the background of a starry sky wrapped in the darkness and silence of night. We represent this not only out of fidelity to the gospel accounts, but also for its symbolic value. We can think of all those times in our lives when we've experienced the darkness of night. Yet even then, God doesn't abandon us. But is there to answer our crucial questions about the meaning of life? Who am I? Where do I come from? Why was I born at this time in history? Why do I love? Why do I suffer? Why will I die? It was to answer these questions that God became man. His closeness brings light where there's darkness and shows the way to those dwelling in the shadow of suffering. The landscapes that are part of the Nativity scene also deserve some mention. Frequently they include the ruins of ancient houses or buildings which in some instances replace the cave of Bethlehem and become a home for the Holy Family. These ruins appear to be inspired by the 13th century golden legend of the Dominican Jacobus da Varagine, which relates a pagan belief that the Temple of Peace in Rome would collapse when a virgin gave birth. More than anything, the ruins are a visible sign of fallen humanity, of everything that inevitably falls into ruin, decay, and disappoints. The scene tells us that Jesus is newness in the midst of an aging world, that he's come to heal and rebuild, to restore the world and our lives to their original splendor. With what emotion should we arrange the mountains, streams, sheep, and shepherds in the Nativity scene? As we do so, we're reminded that, as the prophets had foretold, all creation rejoices in the coming of the Messiah. The angels and the guiding star are a sign that we too are called to set out for the cave and to worship the Lord. Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. So the shepherds tell one another after the proclamation of the angels. A beautiful lesson emerges from these simple words. Unlike so many other people, busy about many things, the shepherds become the first to see the most essential thing of all, the gift of salvation. It's the humble and the poor who greet the event of the Incarnation. The shepherds respond to God, who comes to meet us in the infant Jesus, by setting out to meet him with love, gratitude, and awe. Thanks to Jesus, this encounter between God and his children gives birth to our religion and accounts for its unique beauty, so wonderfully evident in the Nativity scene. It's customary to add many symbolic figures to our Nativity scene. First, there are the beggars and the others who know only the wealth of the heart. They too have every right to draw near to the infant Jesus. No one can evict them or send them away from a crib, so makeshift, that the poor seem entirely at home. Indeed, the poor are a privileged part of this mystery. Often they are the first to recognize God's presence in our midst. The presence of the poor and the lowly in the Nativity scene remind us that God became man for the sake of those who feel most in need of his love and ask him to draw near to them. Jesus, gentle and humble in heart, was born in poverty and led a simple life in order to teach us to recognize what is essential and to act accordingly. The Nativity scene clearly teaches that we cannot let ourselves be fooled by wealth and fleeting promises of happiness. We see Herod's palace in the background, closed and deaf to the tidings of joy. By being born in a manger, God himself launches the only true revolution that can give hope and dignity to the disinherited and the outcast, the revolution of love, the revolution of tenderness. From the manger, Jesus proclaims in a meek yet powerful way the need for sharing with the poor as the path to a more human and fraternal world in which no one is excluded or marginalized. Children, but adults too, often love to add to the Nativity scene other figures that have no apparent connection with the Gospel accounts. Yet each in its own way, these fanciful additions show that in the new world inaugurated by Jesus, there is room for whatever is truly human and for all God's creatures. From the shepherd to the blacksmith, from the baker to the musicians, from the women carrying jugs of water to the children at play, all this speaks of the everyday holiness, the joy of doing ordinary things in an extraordinary way, born wherever Jesus shares his divine life with us. Gradually we come to the cave, where we find the figures of Mary and Joseph. Mary is a mother who contemplates her child and shows him to every visitor. The figure of Mary makes us reflect on the great mystery that surrounded this young woman when God knocked on the door of her immaculate heart. Mary responded in complete obedience to the message of the angel, who asked her to become the mother of God. Her words, "Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word," show all of us how to abandon ourselves to faith in God's will. By her fiat, Mary became the mother of God's Son, not losing, but thanks to him, consecrating her virginity. In her, we see the mother of God who does not keep her Son only to herself, but invites everyone to obey his word and to put it into practice. At Mary's side, shown protecting the child and his mother, stands Saint Joseph. He's usually depicted with staff in hand or holding up a lamp. Saint Joseph plays an important role in the life of Jesus and Mary. He's the guardian who tirelessly protects his family. When God warned him of Herod's threat, he did not hesitate to set out and flee to Egypt. And once the danger had passed, he brought the family back to Nazareth, where he was to be the first teacher of Jesus as a boy and then as a young man. Joseph treasured in his heart the great mystery surrounding Jesus and Mary, his spouse. As a just man, he entrusted himself always to God's will and put it into practice.
Presepe comincia a palpitare quando a Natale vi deponiamo la statuina di Gesù bambino.
When at Christmas we place the statue of the infant Jesus in the manger, the Nativity scene suddenly comes to life. God appears as a child for us to take into our arms. Beneath weakness and frailty, he conceals his power that creates and transforms all things. It seems impossible, yet it's true. In Jesus, God was a child, and in this way he wished to reveal the greatness of his love by smiling and opening his arms to all.
perché pone dinanzi al grande mistero della vita.
The birth of a child awakens joy and wonder. It sets before us the great mystery of life. Seeing the bright eyes of a young couple gazing at their newborn child, we can understand the feelings of Mary and Joseph, who, as they looked at the infant Jesus, sensed God's presence in their lives.
Così l'apostolo Giovanni riassume il mistero dell'incarnazione. Il presepe ci fa vedere.
Life was made manifest. In these words, the apostle John sums up the mystery of the incarnation. The creche allows us to see and touch this unique and unparalleled event that changed the course of history. So the time would thereafter be reckoned either before or after the birth of Christ. God's ways are astonishing, for it seems impossible that he should forsake his glory to become a man like us. To our astonishment, we see God acting exactly as we do. He sleeps.
È imprevedibile, continuamente fuori dai nostri schemi.
He takes milk from his mother, cries and plays like every other child.
Così come è entrato nel mondo, ci
prova. As always, God baffles us. He is unpredictable, constantly doing what we least expect. The Nativity scene shows God as he came into our world, but it also makes us reflect on how our life is part of God's own life. It invites us to become his disciples if we want to attain ultimate meaning in life.
Osservando la stella, quei saggi e ricchi signori dell'Oriente si erano messi in cammino verso Betlemme.
As the feast of Epiphany approaches, we place the statues of the three kings in the Christmas creche. Observing the star, those wise men from the east set out for Bethlehem in order to find Jesus and to offer him their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. These costly gifts have an allegorical meaning. Gold honors Jesus' kingship, incense his divinity, myrrh his sacred humanity that was to experience death and burial. As we contemplate this aspect of the Nativity scene, we're called to reflect on the responsibility of every Christian to spread the gospel. Each of us is called to bear glad tidings to all, testifying by our practical works of mercy to the joy of knowing Jesus and his love. The Magi teach us that people can come to Christ by a very long route. Men of wealth, sages from afar, athirst for the infinite, they set out on the long and perilous journey that would lead them to Bethlehem. Great joy comes over them in the presence of the infant king. They are not scandalized by the poor surroundings, but immediately fall to their knees to worship him. Kneeling before him, they understand that the God who with sovereign wisdom guides the course of the stars also guides the course of history, casting down the mighty and raising up the lowly. Upon their return home, they would certainly have told others of this amazing encounter with the Messiah, thus initiating the spread of the gospel among the nations. Standing before the Christmas creche, we are reminded of the time when we were children, eagerly awaiting to set it up. These memories make us all the more conscious of the precious gift received from those who passed on the faith to us. At the same time, they remind us of our duty to share this same experience with our children and our grandchildren. It doesn't matter how the Nativity scene is arranged. It can always be the same or it can change from year to year. What matters is that it speaks up to our lives. Wherever it is, whatever form it takes, the Christmas creche speaks to us of the love of God, the God who became a child in order to make us know how close he is to every man, woman, and child, regardless of their condition. Dear brothers and sisters, the Christmas creche is part of the precious yet demanding process of passing on the faith. Beginning in childhood and at every stage of our lives, it teaches us to contemplate Jesus, to experience God's love for us, to feel and believe that God is with us and that we are with him, his children, brothers and sisters all, thanks to that child who is the Son of God and the Son of the Virgin Mary. And to realize that in that knowledge we find true happiness. Like St. Francis, may we open our hearts to this simple grace so that from our wonderment a humble prayer may arise, a prayer of thanksgiving to God who wished to share with us his all and thus never to leave us alone. Given in Greccio at the Shrine of the Nativity on the 1st of December in the year 2019, the 7th of my pontificate, Franciscus.
Signore sia con voi.
Sia benedetto il nome del Signore. Il nostro aiuto è nel nome del Signore. Rivolga verso di voi il suo sguardo e vi dia pace. Vi benedica Dio Onnipotente, Padre, Figlio, Spirito Santo.
The Pope's blessing there, his apostolic blessing, given here at the shrine in Greccio, but which, thanks to the wonder of technology, is extended to you, you and your families, wherever you may be, on whatever device you may be following this broadcast. Franciscan community of Greccio is presenting the Holy Father with these beautiful handmade figures from the creche scene, Mary, Joseph, and the child Jesus. Francis thanking the readers, those who read his apostolic letter, you in Italian, I read it for you in English. Do remember that you'll be able to read it for yourself in a few moments on our website at vaticannews.va. As Pope Francis leaves the sanctuary of the crib here in Greccio, we conclude our live broadcast. Our next commentary in English will be next Sunday, December the 8th, when Pope Francis visits Rome's Piazza di Spagna to venerate the image of Our Lady of the Immaculate Conception. Remember that this event is available on our Vatican YouTube channel and our news portal, where you can find summaries of this and our Holy Father's discourses and homilies. Be sure to interact with us on social media. Our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram accounts are updated constantly. You'll find us at vaticannews.va. Until next time, on behalf of Vatican Media, Vatican Radio, and all my colleagues at the Dicastery for Communications, I'm Sean Patrick Lovett wishing you every blessing. Laudato Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ.